Hey guys, welcome back to the LOFT Project. As always, I'm your host, James Robertson. Hey guys, welcome back to the LOFT Project. As always, I'm your host James Robertson. I think this is episode 24, and we have a very, very special guest on the show for you. I've been really excited to talk to this guy. He's an international speaker, a health educator and practitioner. He has expertise in vitamins and mineral deficiencies and treating people with supplements. So without further ado, please welcome to the LOFT Project, Mr. Clive De Carle. How are you doing? Oh, I've lost your sound. Wait, I don't know where.
Oh, my fault. I'm excellent. Thank you very much, apart from being slightly embarrassed.
It's okay. Listen, it happens to me more than enough. So how are you doing? You okay?
Yeah, life is good. Yeah, despite the insanity.
Yeah, like we were saying off camera. Yeah, it's unprecedented times, right? Wow. Like I said to you before, I try not to watch any of the mainstream media. I just try and get on with my life as best I can. So we've got you on. We're going to obviously talk about obviously all your background. And could you tell us a little bit about yourself for our viewers who've not heard of you or know anything about what you do?
Sure. Well, I've been a bit of an entrepreneur. I started a contact lens company. I used to import classic cars and then Japanese imports. I was on Top Gear at one point.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Wow.
I've changed careers a lot. But then 35 years ago, I got ill. What happened was I took one antibiotic and the next thing I knew I was in hospital, and it'd taken a few months, but I'd become so arthritic that I could no longer get out of bed or walk or get dressed. Wow. And I'd become type 1 diabetic. And they put me in hospital. There's nothing else that could be done. And so several weeks in, you know, I was constantly being monitored night and day. And I figured out what was wrong with me and what to do about it. The doctors had given up on me, basically.
So what kind of time scale was that from you taking that antibiotic to kind of having all these illnesses from it?
I would say 3 months.
Oh, wow.
From when it started to being in hospital. So it was quite quick. Within a couple of weeks, I noticed weird stuff with my eyes. And then it just became impossible to get upstairs. And it just got worse pretty fast.
Yeah.
And the doctors had no clue.
Nothing.
Yeah, what do I know? But I said, well, I think it's antibiotic poisoning. But they knew nothing about that as a subject, it appeared. And so really on virtually the day they said, look, there's nothing we can do. You know, they've been offering me drugs, but I kept on explaining I'm not low on drugs. You know, that's not the problem. Lack of drugs, you know.
Yeah.
So anyway, I figured out that I was low on vitamins and minerals primarily. And so I got my wife to wheel me out in a wheelchair and I started taking vitamins and minerals by the truckload.
Yeah.
And all the arthritis, which was really horrible and ugly, and it just went away. Bam. And it took about a year or so for it to completely go away. But if you'd looked at me, you would have thought I was 80 years old when I was 30, because I was in a mess. Anyway, a few, well, about 2 years after that, somebody I knew had cancer, and it was the second time they'd had it. And they said to me, look, you know, I'm not necessarily going to survive this time round. And he copied what I did of vitamins and minerals and changing the diet a bit. But he took another huge step. He changed the doses from what I'd done. Mm. He took 35 grams of vitamin C every day, for example.
Yeah.
Now, that's a lot, 35 grams. Doctors are taught that any more than 1 gram is a waste of time. Mm. But at 35 grams, so he'd been given weeks to live with cancer. He lived another 20 years.
Wow.
And when he did die, it wasn't from cancer.
Wow.
Right?
Wow.
So at that point, I really thought, well, hang on, you know, how much time do doctors study health? In the 5 years at medical school, they do about approximately half a day, depending on where they study. This is in the States and in England.
Wow.
Yeah, maybe it's slightly longer, but it's usually about an hour a year on real nutrition when it comes down to what does a vitamin do, what is magnesium, what is selenium. They really don't know. They don't know at all. And the old knowledge about it has been stripped out of the medical school. So in other words, let's say 150 years ago, you went to the average doctor, family doctor, and they didn't know what was wrong with you. There was something wrong, no doubt about that, but they didn't really know what. One of the standard things they would have done was to give you iodine.
Yeah.
Because iodine has fabulous effects on really the whole body. Every hormone is affected. It affects temperature control. It affects the thyroid function. It's absolutely massive. And they would give maybe up to a gram of Lugol's iodine, for example. Mm-hmm. Now, doctors now are taught not milligrams or grams, but they're taught micrograms. Now, if I were to recommend iodine to somebody, let's say with a thyroid issue, I might recommend that they look at the work of one of the most famous people in this field, Dr. Brownstein, medical doctor, who recommends 50 milligrams for a few weeks, along with selenium and salt.
Yeah.
Those three things alone can not only often fix people's thyroids, but rid people of brain fog. So suddenly their brain is working sharply, their skin problems might end, they might find that where they were having menopause symptoms, they've just stopped or massively reduced, that their temperature, previously out of control, is back in control. And how much does it cost for a year's supply of iodine? Well, $30 would do you for a whole year.
Wow. Wow. I saw,
you see why the medical profession doesn't want people to know.
Yeah, of course. Of course. And when was it, if we go back in kind of history, when was it? Was it the kind of the Rockefeller family who kind of monopolized the medical facilities at the time and just got rid of, I think we had like thousands of years or hundreds of years, if not thousands of years of kind of natural remedies for things. And then they kind of replaced all that kind of stuff with kind of toxic, addictive, petroleum-based pharmaceuticals, right? Something like that happened, right?
That's pretty much the story.
Yeah.
And it's incredible how they did it. Rockefeller and his sort of cronies, they went to the bosses of the medical schools and said, look, now I realize you're probably studying teaching homeopathy or herbalism whatever it was.
Yeah.
We're going to endow you with $10 million.
Yeah.
You stole that rubbish and do what we say.
Yeah.
And would you believe it? They took the money.
Yeah. Yeah.
Who would have thought?
Who would have thought? You know, and then obviously now you have all these medical training facilities, colleges, hospitals, all funded by the Rockefellers, and then only that kind of, only their pharmaceutical, that narrative can be, that's how the doctors were actually trained with that, with the Rockefeller kind of way of thinking in mind, right?
Well, you know, the medical doctors have to follow the rules.
Yeah.
And So, you know, let's say the doctor thinks that broccoli might be a really good thing for this client. Well, they might get struck off for recommending broccoli because it's not in the official NICE guidelines.
Yeah, pretty much. I read something on one of your sites saying it takes up to 90 essential nutrients to perform just basic tasks and stay healthy. Wow, this makes me really worried about my diet. And you mentioned brain fog. I certainly think it's something that I've suffered from myself. Memory loss, a bit like short-term memory loss, I've noticed is really bad. I don't know what these are all side. Obviously, I know right now that my diet is terrible. So I'm probably... and. A lot of, if not all, of modern day food is really lacking in any nutrients at all, right?
Well, you know, if you want a healthy body for the rest of your life, you've got to feed it the best food you can possibly get.
Yeah.
I mean, you really have, because we're self-repairing. If we've got all the minerals and vitamins and so on that we need, then you cut yourself. Well, you heal, don't you?
Yeah.
But if you know, some people don't heal. They've got these sort of open wounds that won't heal properly. Well, that's because they're lacking a few basic essentials that make a human body. Yeah. And it's so simple. I mean, it's so ridiculously simple, actually, for most of us to be well. It helps if you can afford it.
Yes.
You know, because bad food is cheap food, generally speaking.
Yes.
But even if you can't afford it, there are ways around it. You know, you can sprout seeds and all sorts of things you can do.
Yeah.
And one of my favorites, not that I think potatoes are terribly healthy, but I mean, let's say all one's got is a tiny little backyard, you know, no room to spread out loads of potatoes. You can get a bit of chicken wire and shape it in the shape of an oil barrel.
Yeah.
And put a layer of straw, layer of soil, layer of potatoes, layer of straw, layer of soil, layer of potatoes, and build it up to the top and water it. And it'll be sprouting like a green cylinder.
Yeah.
And then a few weeks later, when the potatoes are beginning to get ready, you can start with new potatoes at the top and work downwards.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so there's so many ways to actually grow your own food without too much effort or expense.
Yeah.
And because I think, you know, there's a, you know, all the media's shouting about food security.
Yeah.
Trying to make everybody frightened as hell.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think everybody really does need to consider, well, you know, just in case, let's grow some food. Plant some fruit trees, nut trees.
Yeah. I mean, I'm really at the point where I'm ready to kind of, and I know like we're using technology now to share kind of information and stuff like that, but I'm really at the point where I'm ready just to go live in the woods, like to get rid of all this technology, go live in the woods and just try and grow my own food. You know,
as an ex-organic farmer, I can tell you it's not all that easy.
I know. I can imagine.
Survive. Yeah. There are certain peak times when you've got more tomatoes than you could ever dream of.
Yeah.
But then by the time it comes around to February or whatever. You know, hopefully you've made the cheeses and pickled the stuff and done stuff to get you through. And that's why most of our ancestors tended to live by the sea or by rivers, because even if there's nothing growing, there's always fish in the sea.
Yeah, yeah. Well, until they overfish, like we're seeing. But, yeah, I think most of us would struggle if there was a break in the food chain. I think if there was actually a break in the food chain, a lot of people would struggle. A lot of basic knowledge that probably our grandparents and then before, it was just part of life to grow things in the back garden or whatever. I think a lot of this knowledge has probably been lost in recent times.
It's incredible. Yeah, the lost knowledge in so fast that it's gone. You know, I study some of the health techniques that were common prior to the Rockefeller drug revolution.
Yeah.
And they were very advanced 100 years ago.
Yeah.
Really advanced. You wouldn't think it. And that's all been forgotten, pretty much.
Yeah.
I'm doing my best to bring some of this knowledge back.
Yeah, yeah. And we need more people like yourself, Clive, because it's knowledge that's been forgotten. And, you know, we have the modern kind of medical industry, and it just seems that it's never, just it just seems that cure is not profitable, is it? It just seems that they need to create these things to cover symptoms, but only to cover symptoms if not, so you continuing to be a kind of a customer, a patient, a lifelong customer to the pharmaceutical industry and the medical industry in turn.
Yeah, human cash cow.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, as the old phrase goes, a patient cured is a customer lost.
Yeah.
You know, I saw somebody, or actually the wife of a friend, and the words I'm going to use, if I use words like cure or cancer, it's on the basis that I'm spelling them with a K for legal reasons, okay? Because legally you can't.
Yeah.
Only a doctor can cure cancer.
Yeah.
And so I'm not claiming to be able to do that.
Yeah.
So his wife found a big lump in her breast. Obviously, the doctors wanted to remove it. She took a number of supplements, but the primary, she believed, was she painted Lugol's iodine on her breast, and within 4 months, the lump had gone.
Wow.
And how much did that cost? A fiver?
Yeah.
How much would a round of chemotherapy cost?
Yeah.
£15,000? How many rounds do some people have? 15? You know,
wow.
You're talking £500,000 versus a fiver.
Yeah, obviously a lot less traumatic. I think I don't know what the true stats are, but the statistics of people, how many people even survive having chemo. It's just such a drastic, they're basically poisoning every part of your body, right?
It's horrendous. It's, you know, nobody, if they looked into chemotherapy, would ever do it.
Yeah.
But what happens is that somebody finds a lump or something, and instead of heading where they should have headed to somebody who knows about how to restore health, they panic and run to somebody who would rather suppress the symptoms, extend their life for a couple of weeks, even though it might be horrendous.
Horrendous, yeah.
And they're looking for the problem. You know, if they think they've got cancer, well, they're going to go for scans and stuff to look for it. Now, what does that do to the mind? Well, if you really concentrate your mind on something that you want, I think we are creators, co-creators, and things happen, right? If you think it hard enough, you put the effort in and things happen. So if somebody's more than they probably ever thought about in their life, oh my God, cancer, 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 and they go looking for it, what happens is the doctor might say something like, thank God you got here in time. We're going to operate this afternoon. We're going to put you on a chemotherapy right away. You know, thank God you got here in time before they have time to logically, rationally think it through.
Yeah, yeah. It's kind of like, I've always been with vitamins and supplements that we see in the mainstream shops. So I've always been kind of a little bit dubious.
So you should be.
Yeah, trusting in what these so-called multivitamin. Yeah, I've just always thought, are these just more toxic? You know, I don't know how these things are made. I don't know where, it's hard even to look at the side of labels and read things. It's still hard to know what these things are and what they're going to do to you. So I should be distrusting of them. Yeah.
Well, I mean, Holland and Barrett.
Yes.
Right.
Prime example.
Now, can you trust them? Well, let's not talk about who owns them currently, but who used to own them for many, many, many years? The Carlyle Group. Who are the Carlyle Group? They're arms dealers.
Wow.
Now, you can trust arms dealers with your health because they care at a deep level. So, and it just goes on from there. I who knows, but I would say at least 90% of all the health industry is owned by the bad guys, because they don't want it to work. So a good example is, let's say you go to the high street shop and you've heard that magnesium is what you need and you're convinced. So you go and there's the one that they're pushing. They probably maybe have a few different types of magnesium, but there's the one at the front. It's at the right price. Everything looks good. You buy it. Now, the chances are that it's going to be the one you don't want, which is magnesium oxide. Now, magnesium oxide actually is pretty good if you're constipated, but probably the reason you're constipated is lack of magnesium. then all the oxide will do will give you diarrhea. But if you get a really good, the right type of magnesium, there's several that are good. On the label, it's like just say take one or two, right?
Yeah.
Now, on the label of mine, I say take up to 12.
Okay.
Because people are so scared of most minerals and vitamins and stuff, you know, oh, don't want to overdose, that can be terrible, that often people don't realize that if you want a quick effect, you know, if you're feeling suicidal and you want to feel not suicidal tomorrow, if you've got horrendous muscle pains, arthritis, backache, you're depressed, you've got heart issues like arrhythmia, you're constipated, you've got anxiety, panic attacks, restless leg, whole host of things like that.
Yeah.
You might find that if you take 12 magnesiums a day for a few days, maybe on day one, maybe on day two, you might find, gosh, I feel really different, right? Because magnesium is one of the quick ones. If something takes ages, but magnesium, many people notice in a short time. I mean, a good example, I was on the radio 2 or 3 years ago now with Crow. Have you come across Crow?
Yeah, Crow 777, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he tells this story a few times that his sister had got trigger finger where she couldn't straighten her finger. And she just had an operation, expensive, painful, long recovery time to have her finger go straight.
Yeah.
And he had the same thing. And so I'd sent him some supplements in advance of the radio show. So I said to him, look, take some vitamin C and some magnesium right now. Within 1 hour, his finger had straightened.
Wow.
Live on air. Wow. We sold out of magnesium for 4 months at that point.
Wow. Wow.
So,
I must say at this point, I've received some of your supplements as well. So I must say thank you very much, Clive. I've literally just this week started taking magnesium and all my vitamins from that pack. So we're gonna see what happens.
Okay, you haven't noticed anything yet?
Just in a couple of days, not really, not yet. But again, I don't think I was a little bit wary of just taking a lot straight away. I don't know.
I'm fairly gung ho about it.
Okay,
but I have got a video on everywhere except YouTube entitled Supplements, How to Use Them, that's something like that, where I run through it. But basically, with magnesium, so long as you don't have a kidney issue, then you can go straight to it. If actually you take too much for your body, then you get diarrhea. The body's self-regulating.
Okay.
So you do, you know, if in doubt, you just take them in divided doses over a day.
Yeah.
Same with vitamin C. The body's self-regulating. You take too much at once or too much divided doses over a day. Again, the body will say too much and now you're in the bathroom again.
Okay.
So, I mean, another great example is the mineral selenium.
Yeah.
Now, as with everything, I suppose, I found that there is quality and there's quality. And last three years, I've been using this liquid selenium, which is incredible. And to give you an example, sort of feedback I got, right? I got this guy, for instance, who had been on ADHD medication, I think for 20 years or something like that.
Yeah.
And every time he tried to come off, he couldn't. He never successfully came off it. And he took 7 drops of the selenium over 3 days. And he was doing 1 or 2 other things as well, but it was the selenium that did it.
Yeah.
Came off, no problem. Been off ever since.
Wow.
I had another woman who took 10 drops. She no longer felt the need to drink red wine every night. Back 40 years ago, they were using the same liquid selenium on methadone and heroin addicts in New York with massive success. So that's why you've never heard of it.
Yeah, of course, like everything.
Selenium is, if somebody's pregnant and they want to make sure they don't get birth defects, selenium is one of the big ones, there are others, to make sure that baby is perfect. You know, iodine would ensure, if mother takes iodine, it would make sure that the baby is as intelligent as it could be. All about IQ of children. Some of these, some of these things which are still available, even though the government seem to want to ban most of this stuff. incredible the difference that things can make. You know, all the difference between having a baby that's crippled, you might say, as against a healthy, bouncy one. There's so much I could tell you.
It's very telling that over the past 2 years of kind of lockdowns and everything that's been going on, I've not seen one kind of health official or kind of on TV doctor or anyone recommend taking vitamins or going outside in the sunlight or exercising, eating well, being around your family, which you need. It's all the things that you would deem kind of essential for good natural immunity. They've not promoted any of that at any time during the past 2 years. It's very telling, right?
Got it. No money in it.
Yeah. They've much preferred people staying at home, living in constant fear, probably drinking too much, eating lots of junk food. You know, they were again, very telling. Closing gyms down because it was deemed dangerous, but during the whole 2 years, keeping the likes of McDonald's open and alcohol. You know, it's I have a close friend who's always kind of suffered with kind of mental kind of health issues. You know, and she's just really, 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 really struggled through this whole thing. And she's self-medicated and drank too much. And it's just been really, really awful. So I'd really love for her to watch this and kind of learn a lot more about how she can change her body from being that toxic, acidic body to a more alkaline kind of scenario.
It may not be that she's not alkaline enough. That may not be it.
No.
There are lots of advantages. Let me put it another way. If people are stressed, they're low on magnesium, therefore they could be depressed. In winter, how happy are people? The moment the sun came out last week, whatever it was, how happy were people that day?
Yeah.
Right? Everybody's smiling at each other.
Yeah.
Everybody's having a great time. So vitamin D in winter, for some people, can be a big answer so that they're happier. That can be one thing. Another big one I would suggest, proper hydration. Some people are unhappy because they're dehydrated.
Yeah.
And maybe because they're dehydrated, the body misinterprets the I'm thirsty signal with I'm hungry.
Yeah.
And they eat too much, possibly as a result of that. A few people are low on the amino acid L-tryptophan. And some people, you can find that out in a few days by just trying it for a few days.
Yeah.
If it's for you, some people take L-tryptophan. Bam, they're feeling, why didn't I feel this way before?
Yeah.
You know, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Some people, the essential amino acids cheer them up because that gives more dopamine. There are some interesting things that people can do.
Yeah.
I mean, if somebody's really depressed, I'll try and persuade them that it would be a good idea to go out and help somebody else. Because actually what cheers most people up the most, you know, one of the most rewarding things is when somebody says, thank you. What you've just done for me was really great. You know, we all want to hear sort of thank you, I love you, I think.
You're certainly right. If I'm honest, I'd never even heard of like such things as kind of obviously fulvic minerals or Lugol's iodine as well. I'd never heard of it in that kind of terms. I mean, I don't think most kind of people on the street would know that, right?
Well, they don't want you to know. You know, fulvic minerals, a little bottle, which lasts 4 months, costs, I think, 35 quid or 40 quid. It, again, £10 a month or something. So, you know, your iodine's going to cost you like £2 a month. It's adding up. And the first time I took the type of fulvic minerals that I use, I took them in the afternoon. I woke up the next morning feeling different. It was like my body felt nicer to be in. It was weird.
Yeah.
And second person I gave it to said that they were getting morning sickness because she was pregnant, and that had stopped after 3 days. And I'm not saying this is the cure for morning sickness, but it was in the case of this woman.
Yeah.
You know, because we are self-repairing. People aren't meant to be anything other than healthy. So, you know, she was obviously lacking some minerals somewhere.
Yeah.
So you mentioned, you know, 90 essential elements to be well. It's actually fractionally more than that. But the fact is that if you had no money at all and you wanted the ultimate multi-mineral, what you do is get a bucket and a spade, go into the old forest and dig up some soil, because everything that's ever lived or died is now in the soil.
Yeah.
And you could find a spring or something and put some spring water in the bucket with the earth and stir it around, let it settle, drink the muddy water. Perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect. And that's what fulvic minerals are, except that 30 million years ago, things were different on the planet. There are apparently four times the species that there are now, and supposedly plants and animals were a lot larger at that point of pre-cataclysm. And so the fulvic minerals that I use are, they reckon, 30 million years old, and somehow some geological thing, a huge concentrate of these got stuck in one place. And so they mine. It's only about half a mile square of a mine, and they just take the soil, run water through it, and it's so powerful that just by running water through the soil, they get 4 months' worth of minerals in a tiny bottle.
Wow.
It's not to say that it covers all. There's a little bit of everything, but why you take it is for the trace elements. If you take magnesium, you've got to take several big capsules because it's a bulky thing. But the little trace elements, which, for instance, the friendly bacteria in our gut need to proliferate, they're in the fulvic minerals. And that's often what I think is one of the many things that makes it work. The other thing about fulvic minerals, which is current to right now, fulvic minerals help detoxify glyphosate, Roundup, and they help detoxify graphene oxide. Very, very important.
You see, times have changed, and we're especially in these unprecedented times, and they seem to think that, you know, putting masks on children and spraying disinfectants all around the school and making them wash their hands with toxic hand washes and is beneficial, when kind of, even I was born in 77 and I could, you know, we were left to play in the mud and eat mud and you know, this is how we built our natural immunities up, right? And milk from a mother's breast rather than kind of injecting multiple kind of toxic chemical cocktails into kids. You know, it's different times.
Yes, quite. Absolutely. People need to know how to detox at this point.
Yeah. Yeah, I just think for a lot of people, they're probably, obviously, people are just trying to get on with their lives, and they probably think it's too much or a little bit overwhelming to do their own due diligence and do that kind of research into, like you did yourself, to find out how to live healthier.
I was just going to say that, you know, some years ago, when they were trying to take all my videos down in 2014, you know, I was working with UK Column at that point as their health correspondent, and we were really getting attacked by the government. And so I started a club at that point called Secret Health Club, secrethealthclub.com.
Yeah.
And for the people who don't want to do their own due diligence, it took me 20 years or something, I've put together a sort of an alphabetical list of all the problems, lots of problems that people commonly have, from, you know, arthritis to Alzheimer's to whatever.
Yeah.
And so it's a repository of information, not overwhelming, like trying to find the answer on Google or something. Yes.
Yeah.
There's so much. How do you pick it out?
Yeah.
And so with both the supplement company and the Secret Health Club, I've tried to narrow it right down to the information you really need to know.
Yeah.
So that if you've got cancer or whatever it is, you know, it's not confusing. It's pretty straightforward. So, because my aim is to do myself out of a job so that everybody knows the answer. I don't have to do anything anymore.
Yes.
Yeah, so, I'm just trying to spread the information. Really, hopefully at a relatively inexpensive sort of price.
Yeah. So you've been kind of out there for doing your research and giving talks and for over 20 years, right?
I fixed my own health issues about 35, 36 years ago.
Okay.
And then something like 20 years ago, people started saying, look, you really ought to go out and talk to people about this.
Yeah.
And I was really shy at that point, relatively.
Yeah.
And I never saw myself as like a public speaker. You know, it's just horrendous, you know.
Yeah.
And then suddenly, the first time I got up on a stage, I was petrified. But the second time, I suddenly realized that I had no fear at all about talking publicly on stage. I sort of got over myself somehow.
Yeah.
So it's easy. You know, you hear some people who throw up prior to giving a talk because they're so nervous. It doesn't bother me. I just get a big adrenaline rush. It's great.
Yeah. And you must have kind of heard so many great stories of kind of people who've kind of been to see you talk or used your supplements and kind of healed themselves, almost kind of cured themselves or come back to better state of health because they've been taking supplements and the much needed minerals and things that our body needs.
The stories come in every day, really.
Yeah.
Because people see the videos and stuff. And we are self-repairing. All you've got to do is put the right tools in the tank and everybody's empty. I mean, everybody's low on iodine, pretty much everybody, 95% probably, because if you're in contact with chlorine, you're bathing in unfiltered water, for example, you'll be lower than you should be on iodine. If you're eating bread that comes in a packet, which says flour improver, that's probably bromine, salt of bromine, which will deplete your iodine. If you're in a fluoridated water area where you're brushing your teeth with fluoride, you'll be knocking your thyroid to hell and reducing your iodine levels. One of the really frightening ones is children given, let's say, strawberry-flavored toothpaste with fluoride, and it tastes nice, they then swallow it. Now, that's really poison.
Yeah.
America, it says on fluoridated toothpaste something like, if you swallow more than a pea-sized amount, you should report to poison control. And there are kids swallowing their raspberry-flavoured or whatever it is, toothpaste every day, twice a day. And mum saying, yeah, make sure you brush it more.
Yeah. I've seen kind of evidence or kind of papers saying that if we know the fluoride's an industrial toxic poison, it's got no business being in our water, it's got no business being in our mouth or in our body. It's just very, very scary to me that it just seems that on all levels with the stuff that we wash or the stuff that we bathe in or aftershaves or kind of antiperspirants with aluminium in, or all the everything we kind of use, eat, drink seems to have toxic poisons that are damaging us on every level. Now, sorry, go, Clive.
Yeah, I mean, unless you choose to not poison yourself, everybody is being poisoned. I mean, every time you go to the shops, most of the products are very, very damaging to human health, mind and body. And, I used to have an organic farm. I only eat organic food unless I'm absolutely got no choice. You know, I'm, because I see the results, you know, for 20 years, I've seen clients who are ill and I've seen them repair often really easily and really quickly.
Yeah.
But you have to stop poisoning yourself, ideally. Yeah.
But they've just made it too easy, you know. Like you said before, the fast food, they've made it. It seems less accessible to eat well. It's probably a mixture of people being lazy as well. But it just seems the whole system is pushed in that direction where it's just so easy to have that fast food or that supermarket food rather than go for the organic kind of the organic option, you know. It's
well, you know, we're all enslaved, and most people can't afford good food. And you know, we're run by a bunch of psychopaths.
Yeah, you try to tell people about these things, and obviously, I have no doubt that you've had kind of similar experiences. Kind of talking, if you're trying to kind of inform people about alternative remedies and alternative ways to be healthy, you know, you must have faced kind of attacks and people trying to undermine what you're doing and stuff like that, right?
Yeah. But, you know, I've stopped spending time trying to convince people who don't want to be convinced.
Yeah, but you can't really.
I'd rather spend my time talking to people who are open.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's a fantastic time in a way. You know, things had to change one way or another.
Yeah.
You know, I wonder, you know, I don't have to explain what's going on, but looking ahead to a self-sufficient lifestyle would be good if you could possibly do it.
Yeah. I mean, can we take positives out of what's been going on? Can the human race survive? Where are we going with everything that they're pushing for? I think something that they probably weren't hoping for, it's been a byproduct of them pushing certain agendas, that we are seeing more. I don't know what your personal experience has been, but that we are seeing more and more people kind of awake to certain kind of behavior, the government's behaviors and kind of corporations and in terms of health and stuff like that.
People are waking up, but it's too slow at the moment, and for my liking.
Yeah. So how long have you actually been involved with the production, actually, or kind of having your own supplements, your own kind of brand?
I started, I suppose, making my own stuff 15 years ago or something like that.
Yeah. And how has that been going for you, kind of? Is it going well?
It took a long time to take off, and, you know, I was a one-man band for quite a while.
Yeah, yeah.
But now luckily it's taken off enough that it's become a reasonably large enterprise at this point.
Yeah.
All right, cool. Tiny compared to many things, but for me, it's become.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So where can
my bank manager doesn't ring me up anymore.
So where can, for viewers who are watching, where can people find your products, your supplements?
Well, technically, I'm banned from telling you.
Oh, really?
When the government attacked me about, in early March 2020, I put out videos saying vitamin C will, with a K, cure the naughty thing that I also am not allowed to mention. So certain words I'm not allowed. The government has specifically written to me to say I can't say corona virus. And I can't tell you what my own website is, but it's my name with a familiar appendage like .com at the end, you know, but I can't tell you that. Sorry.
it's insane. That is it's crazy that you can't do that. So have you had actually people trying to shut your websites down and kind of hack you or any kind of attacks like that?
Yes. Yes, all those things.
Yeah.
At one point, I was in Ireland 3 or 4 years ago, And I'd been invited to speak at a Freedom Festival or something like that.
Yeah.
And about 2 days before I was meant to go on, they banned me and said, you can't come. I said, oh, it's a Freedom Festival. And I said, oh, well. Anyway, I thought, well, I'm going to come anyway. Anyway, so I arrive, and the day before, there'd been people with placards protesting me talking there the following day.
Wow. Wow.
When I did turn up, the hotel which was hosting it wouldn't let me in. And so then they finally did. And then there was a bomb threat. And so we all, and then I put on a, they wouldn't let me talk at the venue because of the bomb threats and stuff. And so I talked in a cafe around the corner. I mean, it's just ridiculous. I've had people giving me death threats. You know, it's just, all I'm doing is telling people how to get well. You know,
wow.
But what they really didn't like was I was talking about autistic children.
Okay.
And if you say something positive can be done for autistic children, oh, they don't like that.
Yeah. I would.
They don't like that at all.
No. Wow, but as far as kind of death, like physical death threats, kind of.
Mm. Yep.
Wow. What kind of people were kind of protesting against you? Like, why?
Well, nutcases, I would say. Yeah. It was basically a woman called Fiona O'Leary, who is a well-known anti-activist in ERA.
Okay.
And she has tried to scupper almost everybody who tries to give a talk in Ireland. One day she turns up at my doorstep and she'd
your private residence.
Yeah. And she had a cameraman from the Sun newspaper hiding in the bushes, photographing me at the doorstep with her. I mean, that was the sort of level it came to. Entrapment is what it was.
Wow.
She lied to me. She said she had an autistic child and desperately needed my help. And it's true she had an autistic child, but she was entrapping me to say things on tape. She was recording me illegally. And anyway, I mean, that's just insane. Stupid madness.
And what reason did they give you for banning you from talking?
Oh, well, the fact was that I was saying that chlorine dioxide in the form of, you know, MMS, was reversing people's autism, which is true.
Yeah.
Absolutely true, undisputable, proven.
Yeah.
And it was also shown to reverse malaria and a whole host of things, right? Amazing product.
Yeah.
You can buy it on Amazon, funnily enough.
Yeah.
There's water purifying tablets and stuff. Anyway, because chlorine dioxide smells like bleach, it's chlorine dioxide. It's not bleach, that's sodium hypochlorite. However, they accused me of giving bleach to children. And, you know, but I was lucky I'm not in America. In America, about 100 people got murdered over that and GCMAF. You know, my most viewed video, which got up to about 280,000 views back in 2013 or something, I can't remember, was about GCMAF. You know, that literally doctors got murdered about these two products in America. Crazy. Well,
it is crazy. Certainly in the States, it's kind of, we don't really see the same kind of craziness over in the UK, but yeah, it's certainly, whenever you question a mainstream narrative, it certainly brings out the worst in some people. And yeah, especially the thing I don't understand, trying to help people, trying to reverse the process of these toxins that have caused them problems, and especially in autistic children. I think a lot of these products, a lot of modern day living, we're seeing like heavy metals found in people's brains. Aren't we seeing like I don't know if it's a proven fact, but aluminium, we have like exponential growth in Alzheimer's and MS and all kinds of these neurological disorders that are certainly linked with having heavy metals in the brain, right?
Well, it doesn't help that the government are usually putting aluminium in the water supply.
Aluminium in the water?
Because I can't remember, is maybe aluminium sulfate, I can't quite remember, but one of the aluminium salts is what they call a flocculating agent, which cloudy water becomes clear. So I'm sure that's got nothing to do with it.
I mean, I've always tried to get my head around them putting fluoride in the water, but now I genuinely didn't know about, obviously, the aluminium being put in. But it's probably a lot more. It's probably a lot other things being put in there as well. You know,
about 10 or 12 years ago, I was giving a talk to the Kent Freedom Association or something like that, and this guy stood up at the meeting and said that he was sure that they were putting fluoride in the water in his area. And he rang up the water board several times and they denied it. Then he had another idea. He rang up the town hall and said, are you putting fluoride in the water? I said, yes, we are. Why would a town hall be doing that?
Yeah, yeah. I've often wondered if we did the same thing in our local authorities, if like a freedom of, if they would admit doing that. They're allowed to tell you.
Well, yeah, councils, like the government, like the country, are private corporations working for profit.
Yeah.
I don't trust any authority, really, because at the end of the day, the psychopaths have been in control of the world for thousands of years, I suspect.
Do we see a time where that won't be true? Or is that, are we...
Well, I do. I do.
Do you?
And I've been talking about it for years, but... other people don't seem to see it.
How do we get to that point? How do we get that point?
Well, there are not many psychopaths, are there? I mean, there are not many people running the world. They're the people running the nasty corporations and the politicians and a few of the minions. But actually, compared to the population of England, say, there aren't that many psychopaths in comparison to the rest of us.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I thought years ago, well, how about a TV show like Britain's Got Talent, where you're looking for the sweetest grandparents in the country, right? You'd love them to be your granny and grandfather. And you try and find, it's not just old people, you just try and find people that are super intelligent, super lovable, that you would actually trust to run the fucking country. Sorry. and then he said, look, I'm really sorry to interrupt your life, but we just want you for 1 year only to sort of help in a committee of people who are going to try and help. Now, if you're in doubt about a decision, you know, should we cut the rainforest down to plant more soya, for example, then you could get like a 9-year-old in to advise. You know, which would you like, nine fluffy animals and nice forest, or chocolate McVitie's biscuits that are 3p cheaper because we're using soy oil or palm oil, or, you know. I think it's simple. Is it the Sioux or the Cherokee or some? One of the North American tribes had a congress of 300 women, and they made the decisions. They felt the women were the better ones. I mean, they're probably less likely to go to war than the men. Mm. And the rule was that every decision you made had to be good for 7 generations. And they didn't mean father to son generations, they meant lifespans. So any decision you made had to be really sensible long term.
Yeah.
You know, so it's not like the master plan for how to have a nicer world doesn't exist. But when people don't even realize they're slaves, it's very difficult. You know?
Yeah.
It's slavery is where you do the work and somebody else takes most of the money. Well, that's us and government.
Yeah. Yeah, like you say, most people they don't even know that we're slaves. You know, but just because we can't see the bars doesn't mean we're not in a prison, right?
Yeah, quite. So, I mean, I'm hopeful that people will wake up, but where are the leaders? Well, the leaders don't appear to be there.
It's difficult when these psychopaths and they are psychopaths. I think we can both say that when they have such a powerful tool as the mainstream media, when they control literally every single outlet. And for the majority of people, that is where their truth comes from. If, unless it's on the, you know, unless it's on the TV, it's not real, right? We're seeing that with the virtue signaling that's going on with the whole Ukraine thing that's going on right now, you know, because, you know, and I know I'm going off on a little tangent here, but it just shows you how powerful it is, because 2 weeks ago, the same people who were kind of changing their profile, their Facebook profile pictures, they were putting the borders around saying, I'm triple vaxxed and protecting the NHS and doing my duty, I'm saving the world, are the same people who've now, I mean, COVID's gone now. I think we should all give Putin a pat on the back.
But don't worry, it's on his way back. Don't worry.
Is it coming back now, is it?
Oh, yeah. By popular demand. Stand up, COVID.
An encore. But now they're all sharing, obviously, the Ukrainian flag. And
the good news is that they've locked up or banned all the opposition parties, I think, except the Nazis, and they've closed down all the TV stations. So the only, you know, so that sounds really, well, you know, fair and reasonable,
yeah,
doesn't it?
Yeah.
Nothing to worry about there.
Nothing at all. Right, well, Clive, that's us coming up to the hour mark, so we'll just leave it there. I just want to say, again, it's been a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you so much for obviously sparing us some time out your busy schedule. I really appreciate it. And thank you for the supplements that was sent. I'll put it, I know you can't mention it, but we will obviously put links to your website in the description below. Hopefully people can come find your content and help themselves. So, yeah, thank you so much.
Thanks, James.
Thanks very much.
Lovely speaking with you.
Thanks very much. And we'll see you all next time for another episode of The LOFT Project. Thanks, guys. If you like the content, please press the subscribe button and never miss another episode. Right, that's it. Thanks very much and goodbye.